The American military was on the brink of unveiling a revolutionary addition to its Cold War arsenal on a testing ground marked by a harsh terrain of rocks, dips, and hidden enemy placements. As engineers signaled the start of the test, the silence was shattered by the powerful roar of an engine. An M60 Patton tank, known as the M60A2 Starship, charged into view. The spectators were left in awe by the sleek and unique-looking silhouette of the tank. This was a significant leap forward in armored warfare. Equipped with a cutting-edge turret housing infrared sensors and the capability to launch anti-tank guided missiles. The Starship approached an enemy vehicle at close range and obliterated it with a direct hit with a high-explosive anti-tank round. The vehicle then raced to a fortified position and made quick work of the infantry dummies with a high-explosive shell. Before the dust settled, the Starship was already above the hill, positioning itself to acquire the next target. Completely immobile in the uneven terrain, a highly advanced turret stabilized the ATGM launcher while the crew searched the area for the next objective. Targeting an enemy beyond 2,000 yards, the crew fired an ATGM and achieved a direct hit signaled by a distant explosion. As the smoke dissipated, a message was clear. The Soviet Union would have to reckon with a formidable new opponent. The lineage of the M60 tank stretched back to the M26 Pershing heavy tank, which saw limited action during World War II. From there, it evolved through a series of Patton tanks armed with 90mm guns, such as the M46, M47, and M48 tanks. Introduced in 1960 as the premier of American armor, the M60 marked the culmination of this long lineage. It was crafted to stand tall against the imposing Soviet T-54, boasting heavier armor and a formidable M68 105mm gun. Though weighing a hefty 50 tons each, M60 tanks were reserved for potential use in Europe during the Cold War, yet never saw action in the 10 years that the Vietnam War lasted. Instead, they were employed mainly as bridge-laying and engineering variants. Meanwhile, M48 tanks were deployed in Southeast Asia to take the fight against the North Vietnamese PT-76s and T-54s. Although the M60s would not see combat under American hands during most of the Cold War, they did so under foreign hands. For instance, they proved themselves during the Yom Kippur War, where Israeli M60s tore apart enemy armor against the superior numbers of the coalition gathered against them on the Golan Heights. M60 Pattons were so successful that Israel kept them until 2014, and many nations worldwide still have them in service. These triumphs have not been taken for granted, and the only way the Patton has remained in service more than four decades after its introduction is due to its constant improvements through several variants. The blueprints of the M60 tank date back to the World War II Pershing. To keep it up to date with emerging technologies, the military slowly upgraded it to deal with the latest Soviet Union innovations. In 1963, the Army introduced the M60A1, featuring a redesigned turret that was more spacious, an improved suspension system, and enhanced armor protection. Minor improvements, such as the addition of padded seats, the arrangement of the pedals, and the electronic package, made it easier for the crew to operate the M60. But it was not enough. The Army wanted its tank to be more powerful, but did not know how. The top brass and engineers were still debating whether new tanks should employ conventional kinetic round shells or missiles to provide them with increased range and precision. For instance, the standard M68 gun had a range of around 6,600 feet, while the innovative XM-13 missile system had an effective range that was twice as long, coming up at over 13,000 feet with lethal accuracy. Officers decided to settle the matter in 1966 as the war in Vietnam escalated with the presence of American personnel on the ground. General Dynamics set out to solve the problem by designing a new low-profile turret that would allow the imposing M60 to fire conventional rounds, ranging from heat or high-explosive anti-tank rounds to ATGMs or anti-tank guided missiles. General Dynamics Land Systems thus introduced a turret equipped with a 152mm gun missile launch system that could be used on all M60 Patton hulls, allowing the crews to fire standard shells and anti-tank guided missiles. It was the beginning of the M60A2 Starship, a futuristic tank with a unique-looking turret. With its 152mm gun launcher, the new turret gave rise to a new and technologically superior platform that would pave the way for future American tank designs. The M60A2 Starship was envisioned as a platform to test the feasibility of a tank firing both conventional rounds and missiles, and as a stopgap vehicle until the joint U.S.-German MBT-70 tank project was ready for service. Such an ambitious program aimed to provide the American and Teutonic militaries with a universal tank design that could tackle the objectives of light, medium, and heavy armored vehicles. American engineers decided the MBT-70 would use the same gun launcher turret of the M60A2 Starship and the M551 Sheridan platform, an airborne-ready tank. Army personnel ordered the M60A2 in 1971, but technical difficulties halted the production schedule until 1973. Three different types of turrets were presented, and only one was chosen. The Chrysler Tank Plant in Warren, Michigan, was tasked with delivering the new Starship turrets that would replace the existing ones fitted to M60A1 tanks. Although the initial plan called for replacing every M60 in the American arsenal, only 526 turrets were produced. The Starship was practically identical to the M60A1, both from the inside and the outside, except for the turret. Compared to the A1, the M162 gun and launcher turret drastically reduced the frontal arc, giving the vehicle a different silhouette. A narrow channel allowed each crew member to have a hatch. The loader and gunner were on the right and left sides, while the commander was seated in a turret basket behind the gun in a dome that slightly broke the low profile of the redesigned turret. Mechanically, the A2 turret featured the same upgrade kit as the M60A1, enhancing the gun with stabilization and elevation while the vehicle moved. Moreover, the so-called space-age turret also provided the crew with other features, such as the addition of four grenade launchers mounted on each side of the turret bustle and a mounting point for a xenon white light or infrared spotlight for nighttime operations. The crew could store the infrared spotlight and periscope in a basket at the turret's rear when unused. The Starship was also equipped with the Army's first laser rangefinder, effective at over 650 yards with at least 25% moonlight. The tank's secondary armament consisted of a powerful M85 50 caliber machine gun placed in the commander's rotating cupola and a single coaxial M73 7.62mm machine gun for use against enemy troops. Nonetheless, GI crews would quickly grow dissatisfied with both machine guns as they felt uncomfortable with their handling and performance capabilities. American tankers were fond of the venerable M2 Browning machine gun that had fought alongside the United States since World War II and opted for it instead of the M85. Thus, the reliable M2HB 50 caliber machine gun was again mounted on another new generation American tank. Although the secondary armament supplemented the Starship, its main feature was the A2 turret with the M162 rifled 152mm gun launcher capable of firing HEAT and HE rounds, with the addition of launching MGM-51 Shillelagh ATGMs, or anti-tank guided missiles. The standard rounds had a range of over 1,640 yards and perfectly complemented the role of a main battle tank. As the HE shells were ideal for use against infantry, while the heat rounds could make quick work of anti-armor at close ranges, the ATGM was the answer for long-range anti-armor or fortifications. The heart of the ATGM was the Shillelagh guided system. Upon target acquisition, a small charge propelled the missile from the barrel, swiftly followed by the deployment of four rear-stabilizing fins and the ignition of its engine. Once in the air, an infrared beam guided the ATGM to the intended target. The missile maintained precision and accuracy as long as the gunner kept visual contact with the objective. Here is where the gun and launcher excelled, boasting exceptional stabilization, ensuring a steady aim even over rugged terrain. However, it was far from perfect, as firing the ATGM while in motion remained unfeasible, presenting a notable limitation in possible combat scenarios. Another major issue with the launcher was its breeches, often failing to seal correctly. This flaw led to the release of hot, toxic gases into the crew compartment, posing a significant hazard. Furthermore, the system encountered significant challenges, marked by frequent misfires and premature detonations of standard rounds. These issues were due to unburnt propellant residue accumulating in the bore and breech, often resulting in explosions upon firing. Early iterations of the gun were outfitted with conventional flume extractors mounted on the barrel to address this issue. This eventually led to the closed-bore scavenger system, which employed a compressed air mechanism to expel fumes and gases from the muzzle upon opening the breech. This enhancement mitigated the risk of premature detonations and bolstered the system's reliability and safety during operations. Over 520 M60A2 Starships were built for the Army and Marine Corps between 1973 and 75. Despite its innovative turret and missile system, the shortcomings were deemed too dangerous for direct combat use. The Army decided to relegate them to an overwatch role, supporting frontline tanks with long-range anti-tank support from the rear. Development of the Shillelagh was plagued with mechanical issues, making it unreliable for combat. The Starship was removed from Army service in 1981 with the introduction of the M60A3 variant, the next leap of the Patton's evolution. The existing Starships never saw combat and were quickly turned into M60A3s, featuring a more maneuverable turret and more advanced systems. Nonetheless, the A2's space-age turret succeeded in its secondary objective, advancing toward a more capable American tank design. Its carryover technology served for the MBT-70 project, and more importantly, the M1 Abrams main battle tank that remains in service today. Many of the converted starships were employed by the Marine Corps during the 1991 Gulf War in Kuwait. The last American Pattons rolled into combat against Iraqi armor and destroyed over 100 enemy vehicles at the cost of one throughout the campaign. Such was the reputation of the M60 Pattons that it remains the most widely used main battle tank in many countries across the globe, with over 3,000 of them under active service with Thailand, Taiwan, Saudi Arabia, Turkey, Morocco, and others. As for the unfruitful destiny of the starships, their legacy survives to this day through the M1 Abrams and its battle-tested combat effectiveness.